You're able to see?
Yes, Ekka, we are able to see this.
Yeah, and my voice is okay, right?
Yeah,
it is okay. Okay. Yes. Yeah. So today, as I've been praying about what to share, this is something that was coming into my heart, and let's pray before we start listening to what God has for each one of us. Lord, thank you, Lord, for this afternoon time. Thank you, Lord, for bringing each one of us here, Lord. Lord, we pray that as you speak your word, Lord, help each one of us to listen to it and learn from your word, O Master, because your word is life, and we are what we are. It's only because of what you are doing in our lives, Lord. Help us to grow in you, O Master. In Jesus' most precious name we ask and pray, amen. Yeah, so the topic is growing in Christ. Yeah, generally, if we see in the Bible, there are many comparisons about Christian life with a plant or tree or crop. So I'll just show you some of the verses which talks about which has such comparisons. Psalm 1 verse 3, it says that person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither, whatever they do prospers. So this is, the psalmist is talking about a person who delights himself in the Lord, who doesn't sit with the mockers, who doesn't go for the evil things. Rather, his delight is in the Lord and he meditates on it day and night. For that, the psalmist is saying that that person is actually compared to a tree. And that tree is, as you see in the picture, is planted by streams of water. That means the water is always flowing and there is no lack of nourishment for the tree. And because of that, the tree is always yielding fruit in season, like in season. Because all the time the fruit won't be, borne. The tree will bear fruit according to the season. And also it says, whose leaf does not wither. And whatever they do prospers. So here we see a comparison of a tree, bearing fruit and leaves not withering. Then we see in John 15:5, here again in the last discourse that God, Jesus had with his disciples, this is after the Last Supper. When he's talking, he talks a lot of important things to his disciples. So at that time, he also compares himself to the wine, grape wine, and that he says that I am the vine and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So he says, I am the vine and you need to be connected to me. You have to remain in me and only then you can bear fruit. If a branch is cut off from the vine, then it cannot bear fruit. And that's why he's very clear, apart from me, you can do nothing. So here also we see a comparison of vine and branches and fruit. And we are all very familiar with the parable of the sower passage, where again talks about how the seed is sown. And we all know that the seed is God's word itself and how different people react to the seed that is sown. So Mark 4:20, it says, others like seed sown on good soil. So this is the seed that is sown on the good soil. They hear the word, accept it, and then they produce a crop, some 30, some 60, some 100 times what was sown. So here we see that the seed that was sown in that person is actually producing a lot of crop and harvest. Yeah, and also, in Colossians 2, 6 to 7, Paul is talking about being rooted in Christ. So here he says, so then just as you receive Christ as Lord, continue to live up your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught and overflowing with thankfulness. So if you see any plant or any tree, we don't see the roots. But the roots do go very strong. If a plant or tree doesn't have a proper root, then what happens when things are not going good, they are not nourished well, so they will die. So that is why Paul is saying that we need to be rooted downwards and also built up in Christ. So here we can see the word root, so that we will be strong in our faith. So in all these passages, we see that comparison of Christians, the life of a believer, along with the life of a plant. So if, for example, I've just taken an orange tree's growth. So from a seed, it grows into a sapling, and then you a small plant, and then a tree, and the tree has flowers, and then you have the fruit. And then we all know, once again, the fruit has seeds, and then the cycle repeats. So there is life. If you see plant or tree, there is life, and there is growth, and there is a fruit bearing. So when a Christian's life is compared to a plant or tree, this is something that is expected in all of us also, that we don't remain as a seed, or we don't remain in the state that we started. Rather, we also need to grow in our Christian life, like this, a small seed, and slowly. It's a very slow process. The tree doesn't come up in one day's time. It takes a long time. But then what we need to know is that we should not be where we started. For some of us, maybe 20 years back, we came to know the Lord. And some of you, maybe 2 to 3 years. Some of you, maybe 10 years. But when we look at our lives, we should not be in the same state that we started. There should be growth. There should be maturity. And there should be some sort of fruit bearing that we and God and the people around us should be able to see. So that is something. And also, this growing doesn't stop after some time. Like, we'd never mature like that and then everything is done. No, till the day we meet our Lord, we all need to grow and be sustained by God. And even the big trees, like, for example, if they are bearing fruit, suddenly there is no nutrition now. There is nothing like to sustain the tree. The tree falls, right? So till the life we all meet the Lord, we all need to grow in our Christian life. So that is why in 2 Peter 3:18, Peter talks about the day of the Lord, and he says, he warns people, says, don't get into wrong doctrines. Don't let people take you away from your secure position. And he also says, you have to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. So we need to grow. So this is something that we all need to know, that just like a plant grows, that is what God expects from us, that we all will grow in our Christian life. We should not be in the way, in the time, place where we started. Rather, we need to grow and, you know, mature as believers. So you all are very familiar with this. The plant grows. There are some nutrients which are very, very basic for a plant to grow. So this boy has the seeds, the soil, the sunlight, water, air, and then the seed grows, and then you see the flowers. So the same way in a Christian life also, in order to grow, okay, how can I grow as a Christian? So there are some essential nutrients that are really required. We cannot outgrow that at any point of time in our lives, all our lives, even when you are 90 years old. These are some of the basic ingredients that all of us need in order to grow. So I will just show that. Yeah, these are the essential nutrients for the Christian growth. Knowing and obeying God's word and depending on God through prayer and thriving in fellowship with other believers. So God's word, prayer, and fellowship, it's very, very basic for our growth. The ministry that we do, the way we serve others, it's all an outcome of the relationship that we have with God. That is the fruit. So if we are not growing, then the fruit will not last, because God expects us to bear fruit that will last. That will be a blessing to others. So before concentrating on how we bear the fruit, we need to be very, very sure that we are growing in the Lord. Only then we can know, be a blessing to others. So let us come, all the 90 years, we may not be able to, we may think, oh, we have so much, we know so much of God's word, so much of prayer, but still, again and again, we need God's word to sustain us, We have to depend on God through prayer, and we need to be among believers, the fellowship of believers, to stay strong and to continue in our Christian walk in whatever phase of life, whether you are a single, whether you are a family, whether you are age, any, it doesn't matter at all. All of us need all these nutrients in our life. So today I would be talking more about knowing and obeying God's word. The other two things about prayer and fellowship, God willing, I'll be sharing in December. Because God's word is so vast, I don't know. I really struggle to pick out the verses. So let's start. So knowing and obeying God's word. So here is a picture of God's word, and a tree is just growing. So we all also need to grow out of God's word. Otherwise, we would stop growing. So let's just go through that. Yeah, as you all know that we all have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable seed. And that seed is the living and enduring word of God. So if you go back to your day of salvation, or for some of you, you may not clearly remember the day, but then you will remember some of the things that caught your mind and the things that made you to surrender your life. So if you think about those things, there will always be God's word. Yes, of course, God would have used some men or women to speak those words to us. But what had actually captured us was not the words of men. It was the words of God. Because as the word of God itself says, we know that the word of God is living and enduring word of God. It is living, it is active, it is living and also enduring. It will last forever. So this imperishable seed only was sown into each one of us. And that is why we were born again. We were convinced and convicted by God's word. And that is why we surrendered our lives to Christ. We realized that we were sinners. Others didn't come and say, you are a sinner, and things like that. Rather, we ourselves realized that we are nowhere in line with God. And we are sinners. We are hopeless without Christ. So these things were imparted onto us by the word of God. The Bible is not just an ordinary book that we read. We can say, oh, I finished my BE course. I finished my medical course. I finished this. You can say, I finished reading that book. You can say, I finished reading my novel. I finished reading my technical books. But you can never say, I have finished reading the Bible, because it's alive and enduring word of God, and it is an imperishable seed, and it is active. You all know the qualities of God's word. I don't need to talk about those qualities. All of us know how powerful it is, how active it is. The word of God is so powerful and so, so refreshing to our soul, and how God's word guides us. So these are something that we need to remember, that we are born again through the imperishable word of God. We are born again. Each one of us came to Christ only because we heard God's word, not because somebody just spoke their words. Rather, they spoke God's word. So this is very important, that even when we go and share the gospel to others, it's not our words that is going to make any change in them. It is, again, the word of God. So then we all know, as soon as a baby is born, okay, the first 6 months, they don't drink anything other than milk. They are unable to take solids. So all of us were like that as babies. So, and what do the newborn babies do? They cry for milk, and they don't, like, we eat only 3 meals and in between maybe like some lot of chai. But the babies, they have to drink milk once in 2 hours. Otherwise, they will cry the house out. Like, you can see this baby in the picture. They just open them because they have no other way to express themselves. So because they cannot speak. So they just cry and cry and bring the roof down. That's only mothers and fathers can understand what it means. They can just cry and bring the roof down because they need to live and they need to grow. So that is a mechanism God has placed in their hearts, that in order to live, you need to cry. Because only if you cry, if the babies are nicely sleeping, we will be doing our own jobs. We won't even bother to feed them or take care of them. So God has kept a mechanism that they just cry, and then we have to do something about that. Babies, 1 Peter 2:2-3, it says, like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that you by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. So the word of God is very clear. Peter is saying, just like newborn babies, how they cry out to get the mother's attention, how they cry out to get the milk so that they can sustain their growth. Within 2 months, the babies grow a big size. And within a year, they are completely different from the size they started. That's how God has designed them. Within 1 year, they just grow and they shoot up because they actually crave and they drink the spiritual milk and then they grow up. So this spiritual milk, this pure spiritual milk, is nothing other than the word of God. So we also, as believers, we all know that we started as believers, our journey through God's word. We were born again through the word of God, and we need to, just like Peter is saying, you have to crave for pure spiritual milk in order to grow up in your salvation. And now that you have tasted that the Lord is good, you know that the Lord is good, you know that you are saved. Now you have to cry out, you have to crave for God's milk so that you will grow up in your salvation. So this is again clearly saying that we need to have an urge for God's word. So when we really come to Christ and when we really, you know, are in connection with God, all of us, we would have experienced that we actually have a lot of urge and thirst for God's word. So this is something that is really, really important, that all of us crave for God's word so that we can grow up in. I will give you a life example of King Josiah. Okay, this king is a very interesting king because he was not, he did not become a king when he was an adult. He became a king when he was just 8 years old. He had to become king because his dad was killed, and he had to become king when he was just 8 years old. I think he was one of the youngest kings that Judah had. Yeah, so his story we see in 2 Chronicles 34. Here it says, Josiah was 8 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 31 years. Okay, he became king when he was just 8 years old. And let's see what he did. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord and followed the ways of his father David, not turning aside to the right or to the left. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. As we have, again, I was earlier talking about King Jehoshaphat. So if you see any of the kings, there's always whether they did evil in the eyes of the God or they did right in the eyes of God. And if we see Josiah, even though he was just an 8 year old boy, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. This is surprising because both his father and his grandfather was King Manasseh and father was King Amon, and they both were wicked men. He did not have a godly lineage. His grandfather and grandfather ruled for 55 years, and the father ruled only 2 years. People conspired against him and they killed him. They were wicked men. But this boy, he was just 8 years old. Just see that he chose to do what was right in the eyes of the Lord. And it says he followed the ways of his father David, not turning aside to the right or to the left. And in his eighth year, when he was still young, he began to seek the God of his father. So he's just very young, like 16 years old. And then even 12th year, that is when he was 20 years old, he began to purge Judah and Jerusalem of high places, Asherah poles and idols. His father and grandfather had filled the whole of Jerusalem and Judah with idols and paganism. So this small guy, who now he's 20 years old, he started reforms very young. He just started purging Judah and Jerusalem of high places, Asherah poles and idols. And in the 18th year of his reign, okay, he is just 26 years old at that time, to purify the land and the temple, he actually sends some people to repair the temple of the Lord his God. You won't believe, 57 years, the temple was just used as a storeroom. Nobody bothered to go there or worship God. So this young man, he's just 26 years old, and like 18th year of his reign, he went to send the men to repair God's temple. And then we will see what happened during the repair. So when they were bringing the money out that had been taken into the temple of the Lord, Hilkiah, the high priest, he was a priest at that time, he found the book of the Lord, book of the law of the Lord that had been given through Moses. And Hilkiah said to Shaphan, the secretary, I have found the book of the law in the temple of the Lord. He gave it to Shaphan. So for the past 57 years, the book of the Lord was inside the temple itself. Nobody bothered to read it. Nobody knew what was in it. So you can imagine a lot of people, new people, they wouldn't even have heard about this. Even we don't know whether Josiah knew that such a book was there, because he was not at all aware that something was there like this. So when Hilkiah the priest found the book, he passed on to Shaphan, who was the king's secretary. And then Shaphan, what he did, he went and told the king, and he said, Hilkiah the priest has given me a book, and he read it in the presence of the Lord. And you know what Josiah did? When Josiah heard the words of the law, he tore his robes, because he did not know that there was God's word like this. He did not know. And he realized what a gross mistake they were doing. So that is why he immediately sends people. He tore his clothes. It's in anguish. He tore his clothes and he was cut to the heart, and he's crying out and he says, go and inquire of the Lord for me and for the remnant in Israel and Judah about what is written in this book that has been found. So he says, go to, because those days God doesn't speak to everybody. So they have to go and inquire from a prophet. So there's a prophetess here, and they have to go and inquire. And he says, great is the Lord's anger that is poured out on us, because those who have gone before us have not kept the word of the Lord. So when the word of the Lord was read out to him, he realized that the people had not been walking according to God's word. So he was just doing whatever was coming to his mind. He was cleaning the, he knew that he has to worship the Lord. He knew that he has to be faithful to God. So he knew that the pagan worship is not required. So he was cleansing all that. And then he thought, let me clean up the temple and restore it back to glory. But he did not realize that when he actually heard the word of God, he realized that how much they had deviated from the word of God, because he says they have not acted in accordance with all that is written in this book. So he realized that we have gone so much far away from the book of the law. And so there will be a great anger that will be poured out on us. And then I didn't put those verses. The prophetess, God speaks through the prophetess, and God says, yes, I'm going to bring all these punishments on the people, but because you have humbled yourself, that is our God, great God. When somebody humbles themselves, even Ahab, when he humbled himself, God heard his prayer. So God said, I won't punish during your time. Rather, I will not do this. You go in peace. And but God says, because of all the lawlessness that was in the land, there will be punishment, but it will not happen in your time. So then what happened? Josiah, he realized, okay, this is something that we have all been doing. So let us get back to the word of God. So verse 29 to 31, I will read it. Then the king called together all the elders of Judah and Jerusalem. He went up to the temple of the Lord with the people of Judah, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the priests and the Levites, and all the people from the least to the greatest. He read in their hearing all the words of the book of the covenant, which had been found in the temple of the Lord. So if you see the picture, it's not one simple book like us. No, they had a lot of scrolls. So he just made them stand there and he read the whole book. I don't know how many hours he read it. He didn't even allow others to read it. He read it. He read it. He made all the people gather there and he read all of the words of God. And then he also took a pledge. He made a covenant. The king stood by his pillar and renewed the covenant in the presence of the Lord. So what was the covenant? He said, I will follow the Lord and keep his commands, statutes and decrees with all his heart and all his soul, and to obey the words of the covenant written in this book. So he made a covenant. Lord, okay, we have missed it. We are sorry. But now, from now on, we will follow your word and we will keep your commandments with all your heart and soul, and we will obey what is written. So this is the covenant that he made. And he also made the people to take the pledge. Then he had everyone in Jerusalem and Benjamin pledge themselves to it. The people of Jerusalem did this in accordance with the covenant of God, the God of their ancestors. And then we also see Josiah removed all the detestable idols from all the territory belonging to the Israelites. And he had all who were present in Israel serve the Lord their God. So he, not only he followed the Lord, he also made sure that everyone in his kingdom follows God. So, and so he made them, all of them, to commit to read and follow God's word. And it says, it's beautiful. It says, what an exemplary king he was. As long as he lived, they did not fail to follow the Lord, the God of their ancestors. And there's a beautiful verse in the Bible, 2 Kings 23:25. It says, neither before nor after Josiah was there a king like him who turned to the Lord as he did with all his heart and with all his soul and with all his strength in accordance with all the law of Moses. So neither before. So if you say, if you take even King David or King Solomon, God's word is saying that even they were not a match to Josiah. Why? And also there was no other king who was a match to him later on. Why? There was no other king who turned to God like he did. Because he knew that, oh, I didn't know God's word, but now that the God's word is in my hands, I am going to turn. And he did a full 180 degree turn, and he said with all his heart and with all his soul, with all his strength, in accordance to the law of the Lord, he lived his life. He based his life on the word of God. And then because of that, we see a lot of blessings. So what had happened when the word of the Lord was lost in this story? If we see, around 57 years, the word of the Lord had been lost. It was during the reigns of wicked King Manasseh and his son Amon, that is actually Josiah's dad. You all will know that it is not that the book of the law was lost. It had been forgotten, right? It was not lost. It was not lost. Like when you say, I have lost something, then that means you don't know where it is. You don't know where it is, and you don't know where it is kept. But when you say, I have forgotten, then that means you know where it is, but you have forgotten. So there is some difference. So here the people had forgotten about God's word because even though it was inside God's temple. So they had actually forgotten God's temple and they had forgotten God's law. So that is how the word of the Lord had got lost. So because of that, people did not know what was in God's word. When they don't even know, even Josiah, the word of God was new to him. He did not even know that there was something like this before him. Maybe he didn't know at all, because when he was born, he was just 8 years old when he became king, and he didn't know, because 57 years the word of God is lost. So then he wouldn't have even heard such a thing. So when he did not know that there was something like God's word, and in God's word there are instructions on about what God, who God is and how God wants us to live, then they did not know only that there was something like that. So they did not live in obedience to God. So Josiah actually, but when he got the word of God, he realized the seriousness of it. What will happen if we don't live according to God's word? And so he pledged himself to know and follow God's word. And he also made the people to do the same. And so we see that there was a restoration and blessing of God on him and the people. And as God promised, in his time, it was all peace. There was restoration and there he removed everything and people followed the Lord. So that is a complete restoration and blessing of God, because Josiah got the law of the Lord and he made everyone to take God's word seriously and know God's word and also follow God's word. So to know God is to know his word. If we don't know God's word, we cannot know God. Because God's attributes, God's qualities, God, who God is and what he did for us, what he is going to do for us, everything, he doesn't come and talk to each one of us like that, okay, directly. He has given his word. And to know God, to know who God is, to know what God wants each one of us to do, we need to know his word. So knowing God's word is actually getting to know who God is. Okay, so now it comes to our own personal lives. Okay, so we all saw how we are born again through God's word. We have to crave God's word just like a newborn baby in order to grow up in our salvation. And we also saw that we need to grow up in our Christian life and we need God's word in all our lives. We need to know God's word and we need to obey God's word. So where is God's word in our lives? God's word, is it lost or is it forgotten? Or are we just sustaining ourselves with some of the sermons that we hear here and there, Sunday sermons, and once in a while hearing some great speakers speak? Is that all actually what we are hearing or knowing God's word? Psalmist in Psalm 19 verse 10 and 11, he says, they are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb, honeycomb. So he's talking about God's word, the law of the Lord. He verses 7 to 9 also, he talks about the word of the Lord. His law is perfect, it's righteous, it's all, makes wise the simple. And then he says, more precious than the gold. Is God's word more precious than the gold in our lives? Is God's word so sweet in our, like honey in our lives? We all have tasted the Lord. We all know that he is the most wonderful person that we all have, most wonderful gift that we all have in our lives. And do we consider his word as precious as gold, sweeter than honey? And it says, by them your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. God's word warns us and tells us, don't do this. The world around us has a different standard. They have based on their own human standards. They have different value system. But when it comes to God, there is only one standard. There is no other, like God does not give some three A, B, C, D multiple choice question and says, you can do this or you can do that or you can do this. No, he has nothing like that. He has a very strong, correct way of handling things. So he says, this is my standard. Okay, and that's it. There's no other extra like slightly tilted or no right side, wrong side, left side. No, nothing like that. As Sam was telling, the devil is trying to attack us from all the sides. So what does he attack? He attacks the truth. He attacks the truth. He says, it's okay. It's fine. You don't need to do it. It's all fine. Everybody does it. You are not the only exception. Things like that. But then our God's word clearly warns us. So we know that, okay, in spite of what the world tells us, we know that this is wrong. The Bible clearly says that. So I cannot do this. And also when we keep God's word, there is great reward. There is great reward. Yeah. And so, as we also saw how we can agree, what is the great reward? We know that God is pleased with us. We are living a life that is pleasing to God. We are in line with God, and God is with us. When we are walking away from God, of course, God will not be with us. We are the ones who have to come back and align ourselves with His standard. So we need to be very sure that we cherish God's word. We crave for God's word. Yeah. And again, Matthew 4:4, Jesus answered. This is the answer that he gave the devil, because the devil said, you are 40 days, you are hungry. You just make the stones bread and you have it. Then Jesus answers and says, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. So many of us take it very seriously about our physical nutrition, like healthy food, eat fruits, vegetables, you should not eat that, you should eat this, in between, I need this, I need that, otherwise I will be sick, and we take a lot of kashayam and everything to boost our immunity. We give lots and lots of, and most of us women, we spend a lot of time cooking, and we find fault with the taste and we say this and that. So the physical nourishment to this body, which is here today, which is going to die after some time, it's a very short life that we have. But we give so much importance to the physical food that we all eat every day. We keep planning, okay, lunch I should have this, dinner I should have this, tomorrow I need to have this, then I need to order biryani, or then I need to make this. But God is very clear. He says, we don't live on bread alone, because this is a physical body. What about your soul, which is going to live forever and forever with the Lord? We need to nourish our soul also. That will happen only when we read God's word. Because Jesus, even when he was just 12 years old, you remember when he went to the temple, he could just quote God's word. He used to sit and argue with the teachers of the law. It was not that because he was God. It's because he gave importance as a child. He spent time learning God's word. And so that is why he was able to talk scripture so much. So the same way, we all also need to take this nourishment seriously, like how the newborn baby craves for God's word. You know, some of the great men and women of God, like I think Bhak Singh and all, I've heard, if you read their biographies, as soon as they came to Christ, they did not have any food. They just sat, read the whole Bible. They were just reading. That much was the craving for God's word. How is it for us? Are we just nibbling here and there? Somebody talks, that is enough for today. I heard one verse today. I read one status of somebody, or I just saw one devotion, and I heard that. No, when I was driving the car, I just heard a sermon. And we just think that is enough. That is not enough. Our life will not grow if we do not take our spiritual nourishment seriously in our life. So because we live not on bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Yeah, so I want to give another example is Joshua. Joshua, Moses had died, and Joshua had to take this leadership, and he had to take care of the people. He had to lead them. He had to fight battles, and he had to allot the lands to all the different people. And it's 2 million people. It's a mahot task. It's not a simple task. We have a lot of to-dos, right? You say, I have so much work to do. I'm so busy. I have this, I have that, I have this. And just think of his schedule, how would it be? He had to lead 2 million people, and his great leader was gone, and he is in his shoes, and he has to lead them. He has to fight battles. He has to allot land to these people. It's a huge task. So his to-do list would have been like, we cannot imagine his to-do list, but God only told him this. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. I know what you are into, but you do only one thing. What is that? Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. He said, you speak God's word. You meditate on God's word so that you will be careful to do whatever is written in it. Only when you know God's word, that's why I wrote knowing and obeying. Without knowing what is there in God's word, we cannot obey. We cannot just still live on a few psalms here and there, a few favorite passages here and there, and just be okay. That's enough. No, whenever we feel we have to read God's word, some people, they'll not turn here and there. They'll just go to psalms, read a few psalms and be happy. Okay, fine, I'm done. No, it's not like that. We have to read the whole of the word of God, and we need to obey God as and when we learn what God wants us to do. And we have to be careful to do everything in it. Then only we will be prosperous and successful, because God himself will give us the success. So a few more slides. It's like as I was telling about the spiritual milk. The babies cannot remain babies. They need to go on to solid food. So in our spiritual lives also, we cannot hear the milk is talking about the elementary truths of God's word. So we cannot just, as I was telling, no, we cannot just thrive on a few parables, a few, only sermons, hearing sermons from others, only psalms. We cannot thrive on that all our life. Then we will not grow. So that's why Hebrews 5:11-14 says, we have much to say about this, but it is hard to make it clear to you because you no longer try to understand. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. He says, you need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness, because you are always thriving on milk. You are not going to grow up. But solid food, as we see, this girl is nicely biting on her food. So we need to also mature. We cannot just read few verses which are very comfortable to us and then say, okay, I know God's word. No. We need to mature. And how do we mature to solid food? By constant use, have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. I'll read it again, but solid food is for the mature who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. So as and when we continue, we use God, that is constant use, that is we obey God's word, we live according to God's word, and then we see how our lives are changing, how I have been transformed by the word of God, and we can distinguish, okay, when somebody tells something, I can clearly know, no, there's something wrong. This is not what the word of God says. Because we should not be like reed shifting here and there with all types of doctrines coming, thrown upon us through net and website and things like that. We need to be mature by constant use of God's word and train ourselves so that we will be able to distinguish good from evil. Only then we will be able to start eating solid food and grow up in our maturity. In Acts, we read a very interesting passage. Okay, it's about the Berean Jews. So after Thessalonica, Paul and Silas were sent to the Berea, and as usual, they went to the Jewish synagogue there. And I'll read this verse. It says, now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness, examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. As a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek men and many Greek women and many Greek men. So here we see that the word of God says they were more noble. Why? Because they received the message with great eagerness, and they also examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Because what Paul was telling them was something new. He was telling that Christ had come and he was crucified and the word of God has been fulfilled. So when he was coming and preaching the good news to them, the Berean Jews just didn't take it lightly. They took it and they went to their homes. They examined the scriptures to see what Paul said was true. And when they realized that it was true, they believed and they grew strong. So that is why the word of God says they were of more noble character. Think about us. If somebody is bringing something new and we have not read that portion of the scripture, it's good if we can just go make a note of it and go and read it for ourselves instead of just believing. These people, of course, they didn't know who Paul was, but we all know who Paul was. He is a great man of God, a great preacher at that time. They went and examined the scriptures to see what Paul said was true. So if we also need to take it not lightly. We cannot just take anybody's sermon just like that. If you feel that something is new or something is wrong, it's better you go and verify with the scriptures. Scriptures is with each one of us. We can easily go and verify. So here I just want to give a thing that each of us, as I said, all our lives we need to grow. So it is a good practice if you can have a note with you when you listen to sermons, Sunday sermons or any of the Bible studies. It's good if you can just note down the verses and the main points. And then later on in the week, if we can just go through those verses, you will really be very, very strong. And even if somebody has taught you something wrong, you will be able to identify that. So that is a character of nobility that we can exhibit and we can help in our growth. And finally, John 15:7-11, this is the part where Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. He also says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. That means if God's word remains in us, when we pray, our prayers will be answered. And this is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. So when God's word remains in us and when God answers prayers and when we start bearing fruit, it brings glory to God. And it shows everybody else that we are God's disciple. And also he says, as Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love. If we just say, Jesus, I love you, but I don't obey God's commands. He says, if you love me, you obey my commands. We heard again and again today that in order to show that we love God, we have to obey God. So in order to remain in his love, we need to keep his commands. Just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. We all know very well, he kept his Father's commands 100%. He just literally completely obeyed his Father, and we know that how he remained in God's love. And so he's saying that I'm telling all of these to you because so that my joy may be in you, that and your joy may be complete. So as a summary, I just want to say that all of us in our Christian lives need to grow all our lives. Our growth cannot just stop the day we feel, oh, I know this, I know that, I'm doing this ministry for God. Whatever it is, we need to grow in God. We need to be fruitful. We need to grow in maturity. So in order to do that, we really need to know and obey God's word. We need to know God's word. We need to know what is there in God's word. Only then we can obey God. And we also need to depend on God in prayer and also give importance to fellowship with believers. So those two things we will discuss, God willing, in the next time. But so in order to know God's word, we need to really spend time every day reading God's word, sitting at the Lord's feet, hearing his voice through his word, and then know what God is telling us and then obey it, live it, constantly put it in use in our lives. and so that we can all be mature and we can bear fruit, and we will be able to show to others that we also are God's disciples, and that will be to God's glory. Finally, I just want to leave with you to this one verse. When there was some hard teaching, many of the disciples left Jesus. And then Jesus turned to the 12 and he said, "Are you also going to leave me?" And you know what Peter said? He said, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to know and to believe that you are the Holy One of God." Is this the word that each one of us have? Yeah, sometimes our lives are tough. Sometimes the word of God is very correct, very strict with us. It corrects us. Some things are hard, but one thing we all can know, that we know this God. We have come to believe in him and to know him, that he is our Christ, he is our Savior, and he has the words of eternal life. In this world where the words don't hold true, he is the truth, and he says, "My words are truth." So he's the truth, and we need to hold on to him and to his word. So we can we all also remember and tell the Lord every day, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life." And let us, all of us, commit to grow in Christ through knowing and obeying his word, because that's the only way that we can be sustained and we can mature in Christ. Let's pray. Lord, thank you, Lord, for this day, O Master. Thank you, Lord, for the word that came to each one of us, Lord. Lord, in our lives, Lord, help us to realize and remember that we need to grow in you. We need to mature in you, Master. We cannot just continue to be, Lord, in the state where we were earlier, O Master. We need to grow in you. And Lord, in order to grow, Lord, help us to know you through your word, O Master. Yes, Lord, your word reveals who you are, and your word reveals to us what we are, what we need to do on this world, in this world, O Master. Lord, help each one of us to give our time and effort to study your word and to know what is there in the word, and be strong men and women of word, O Master. Yes, Lord, help us to be men and women of word, O Lord, your word, O Lord, as Joshua was expected to speak the words, O Lord. Even help each one of us to speak your word, because your word has life and it can produce effects in every place it is spoken out, Lord. Lord, we pray that we will be people who will know your word, meditate on your word, live out your word, and also speak your word to others, O Master. Help each one of us, Lord. Help us, and we commit ourselves into your hands, Lord. In Jesus' most precious name, we ask and pray. Amen.